That looks like a powerful performance. But of course, close to your heart. And although you're Mexican, you still live in Europe and you live in Italy. But I guess all Latins are very much alike, aren't they?
Well, yes.
The Latin temperament. You live in an area I love and have visited.
Yes.
Around Castel Gandolfo.
Yes.
What is that lake?
It's Castel Gandolfo, the lake of Castel Gandolfo.
Oh, God, yes. That's unbelievable.
Yes, yes, yes.
Looking down, that's where the Pope summer residence is and where Pope Paul died.
Yes.
And you look down on that beautiful... Are you in that village on the other side?
Yes, on the other side, Albano. And
Rocca de Papa? Are you near Rocca de Papa?
No, no, Rocca de Papa is on the other side.
Oh,
across. But there are about, 10 or 12 villages around there, and... The interesting thing is that I walk to, you know, I hike a lot, and I run a lot, and I run around the lake down below, Castel Gandolfo.
I thought you were a walker, not a jogger.
Well, the same thing. I mean, sometimes I...
No, there, no, no, there is
well, really,
a...
Really, is there a distinction
jog.
Now?
Oh, yeah, you lift really? Your feet and go like a son of a gun. I rather walk.
No, no, I walk.
Yeah.
Yes. Now and then I run if a dog comes after me.
Yeah. You and Pope John,
yes,
they used
yes.
to call, over there they used to call him Johnny Walker.
Really?
Yeah. It is true. All over Italy. I remember in an audience with him,
yes.
and he used to talk about it himself.
Yes.
His first words in an audience were, this was the great Pope John, he said, I once was a corporal in the army, and now I'm a corpulent pope.
Is that if I do?
What are they saying in the villages about a Polish pope?
No, they like him. They like him.
Yeah.
They like him tremendously. As a matter of fact, somebody referred to the fact, I made a picture. Now,
well, now, you want to hear a story, Shoes of the Fisherman.
Yes.
How prophetic that story.
Yes, that's interesting because we made it about, what, 8, 9 years ago. And, of course, the reviews all said, you know, it's, of course, it's impossible. I mean, they'll never elect a pope other than an Italian. And it's all fable and this and that.
And a pope then, from?
Exactly.
A Soviet bloc.
Exactly.
Country.
And
it all came true.
May I say, and I hope I'm not saying something... that when I get back to Castel Gandolfo, I'll have my wrist slapped. But they went to see Pope Jean-Paul
II.
They went to a cell in Poland, and the two books were the Bible and the Shoes of the Fisherman. Yes.
And, isn't that amazing?
So I'm, yes, it's interesting because if you've seen the picture, The first night after the coronation, the Pope goes out on the town, as you remember, because he wants to get back with the people. And and the same thing happened to our present Pope. He went out. And I must say that the Italians are absolutely crazy about him.
Do you have a wonderful life there, Tony?
Yes, but I must tell you.
You're cut off from...
Yes, I must tell you, I...
The fringe benefits of your profession.
What are they?
Well, the glamour and the...
Oh, no, that's nonsense.
Huh?
No, that's nonsense.
I can't picture a disco in Gandolfo.
No, but I don't think I've gone to a disco. I mean, that's not where my life is.
More fun than walking. I'll
no, but I must tell you, better for your digestion,
yeah.
too. No, but I must say that I miss all this. I mean, you know, I just... You know, people say to me, why aren't you living here? Frankly, and I know this sounds... crazy, is it, there's very few pictures that I can do in this background. I mean, the next two pictures, for instance, that I have, one is going to be in South America, and the other one is going to be in Libya. I mean, you know, just that pictures don't come along that I can afford to live in Los Angeles. I don't know if anybody can afford to live in Los Angeles anymore. It's so expensive here now, anyway.
Would you like to live in Paris?
I must tell you a story about Paris.
It's a lot cheaper anywhere in America. I mean, New York is...
Any place is cheaper
half
than Paris.
The price of Paris.
Yes, yes. Terrible.
$50 to fill your gas tank. American
yes,
money.
Yes, that's true. Well, no, the same thing in Los Angeles. And the same thing in Rome, by the way.
Is it $50?
$2.50 a gallon of gas, yes.
We are the cheapest country in the world for gasoline.
$1.10 for cigarettes. I gave up cigarettes, by the way. $1.10 cigarettes. Yes, it's very expensive.
Is there pain... Any pain for you when you come back and see this town?
Well, it's very strange, I must tell you. You've touched upon a very, very tender nerve. I love Los Angeles, you know, with all the pain and everything. And it's interesting. My life in Los Angeles was most interesting because I lived, as I say, in down in Boyle Heights, the other side of Boyle Heights, and slowly we worked our way across Main Street. Then we lived on near Temple and lived by the Amy Semple McPherson Temple.
You worked for her?
Yes, I worked for Amy. And then, you know, we kept moving up, and I kept moving up to the Silver Lake District, and then finally out to the beach and to Bel Air, finally made it to Bel Air. And so, you know, you can't deny this whole existence. I mean, that's practically...
Isn't your life more interesting than the roles you play?
That's a terrible question,
I know. But I mean, when you stop and think of it, isn't there a great scenario in your whole story? I mean, a kid smuggled in a coal car, comes to Los Angeles, knows poverty and a tough street life like no other kid, then works for Amy Semple McPherson,
yes.
Then goes with Mae West. I didn't mean to bring that up, but... Then moves on uptown and suddenly becomes one of the most powerful actors of film. I mean, that is a great story of hope and accomplishment, guts,
yes,
romance. I mean, that's a five-parter.
Yes. But I hope, I mean, it's not written yet, you know. I mean, the story's not over, I hope. I still have the third act to play out, I think. And I just hope it'll get more interesting.
I'm making you nervous, aren't I? He's used to being around Castle Gandolfo with a glass of red.
No, and I suddenly realized I should have worn a tie.
No.
It's been bothering me all along.
Let's see another scene from The Children of Sanchez. You persuade, and I use the word carefully, persuade your son to stay with his family.
Well, may I digress here for a second?
Go ahead.
Oh, goodness. My son, my real son, Duncan, whom I love dearly, was cast in this picture. I had nothing to do, by the way, with casting him in the picture.
So this is your son that we're going to see?
This is my real son that you're going to see. And there was... May I tell you a story? It was interesting because I suffered all the pangs. I've never been as nervous. I mean, I have done scenes. I've done theaters, you know, with Laurence Olivier. I've played with some of the greatest actors in the world, I've never been as nervous in my life as doing a scene with my own son. And there was a scene where he was supposed to come into the house, and he was coming in too late, and he'd been drinking. And I was supposed to get up in the script and hit him and whip him. And I tell you, the first place, my son is 30 years old. And I was terrified at the moment. And I finally went to the director and I said, listen, do I have to hit my own son? Is there some other way we can play this scene? He said, Tony, what's in the script? I said, yes, but you see, and I went into a long, to this very day, he doesn't know why I refused to do the scene. And I said, you know, I think it'd be much more powerful if I just scolded him. And I did him.
Here's the scene. Children of Sanchez.
No, this is not the scene.
This is not the scene with your son.
This is a scene with my son. And again, unfortunately, you're going to see a very, very personal, this whole picture is so personal, you're going to see a very personal moment between father and son that I think is very touching.
Children of Sanchez.
Manuel, I have to tell you something. Son, father's dead.
I know.
Thank you.
keep on running. When are you going to stop running? You're a man now. Think about your children. I won't let you leave. Son, you'll have to kill me first.
Sanchez. In a moment, Dolores Del Rio. I've only seen this lady once in my life in person. I've seen all of her motion pictures, and I've always loved her. And she was in a restaurant, Sardi's in New York, and I was sitting at another table, and I couldn't eat. Now, for me not to eat, you have no idea what kind of pain that is. I was so amazed just to see her sitting there. Once known, widely known, as the most beautiful woman in the world. I've read that many times. When you see her, you'll find out that she can still lay claim to that title. She broke into Hollywood during the silent era. She has a major role in The Children of Sanchez, giving her a career that spans 50 years, and it gives me great pleasure to present the beautiful Dolores Del Rio. I don't even want to pass in front of you, which I have to do. You don't mind if I step over? You play his mother-in-law?
Oh, my goodness.
That's right. How do you do that?
I do.
Do you?
Yes, I do.
You should have refused the part.
Why?
Play his daughter, for heaven's sakes.
Oh, no.
Play my daughter, will you?
Your daughter, that's better.
I did. I stared at you in a restaurant. I could not eat. It was at Sardi's.
Well, you're very kind.
You would never remember it. It was in the late 60s, and there you sat right there. And I assembled, as each, and I knew all the waiters, as each Spanish waiter go by, I'd say, do you know who that is? Do we know who that is, you crazy? Of course we know who that is. When did you leave Hollywood?
I left Hollywood about, I never did leave Hollywood, really, you know. I have returned from Mexico to Hollywood a few times to do films here.
But your residence was?
The last one was Cheyenne Autumn with John Ford. And once in a while, yes, I work here.
But your residence was a long time here in Hollywood.
Oh, yes, for 16 years I worked here. And in 1940, I returned to Mexico and began what I call my second career. I pioneered, you know, along with a few other actors and directors, a motion picture, a budding motion picture, and I think we did some very nice films there.
And you've been doing
stage
work, too.
Oh, yes, yes, I work on the stage, too.
What brought you to America in the first place, Miss Del Rio?
Well, in Mexico City, at a party, I met an American director by the name of Edwin Carew. He saw me, and he said, you could be the female Valentino. This was 1925, and Valentino was, you know, the greatest star in Hollywood. And he said he represents the male, the Latin male on the screen, and I think that you could be the female Valentino. So I was very much intrigued, and I thought it would be fun and exciting to come over, spend a month here, work, you know, in a picture, and return to Mexico City. And I never did return. I
stayed
16 years.
With a fabulous career here, and many of our most famous leading men, too. Were there pictures, though, that you were cast in, though, that discouraged you?
No, sometimes, well, I think every actor gets discouraged once in a while.
Did you fight
back? You don't like the parts that you have. You fight, but it doesn't do you much good.
No,
you know.
No.
One of the reasons I returned to Mexico and stayed in Mexico all of these years, working either on the stage or in motion pictures, is that I could, I have more freedom, you see. I could do more the type of things that I wanted. And in Hollywood, unfortunately, there is no secret.
It's not a special soap, a special...
No, it's a waste of time, all the creams and the soaps and all of those things that women spend millions of dollars on. They're
you,
no good,
you know. You exercise, that's what you do.
No, I don't like
no,
exercising.
No, don't like exercising. See, you're not supposed to say
I
all
walk,
this stuff.
I walk, you know.
Oh, you walk? You
I like to walk.
Do you ever bump into Tony? In Italy? That's a long
walk.
Oh,
I wish I had. I think it would have been lots of fun. No, no.
You're a walker.
Yes, I like to walk, but not jog, you know. No,
no,
that's
no,
not
don't
good.
No, move
that's
anything
very bad.
Around.
No,
no,
that's
no,
very
no.
bad for you.
Special foods?
I like to walk. No. No, I've never been on a diet. I don't believe in diets. I think your body needs everything.
Oh,
the grease,
I've
the
always
sugar,
felt
everything.
That. God.
But.
Oh, wait a minute. Here comes...
Ah, no, there is a but.
There is a big but.
Moderation.
Moderation.
That's right.
Yeah.
Discipline.
That's the
moderation.
But I hate.
You see, ah, that's the bad one.
Oh.
For that, you have to have a lot of discipline. I don't smoke. I don't drink. But I've never been on a diet.
But do you ever have any fun?
I do.
Do you?
I do. I do, and I've had, I mean, it's present and past both.
Do you know, rich people are always thin. Did you ever notice? You know why?
Yeah.
I don't like going to rich people's homes for dinner. They don't eat.
Yes.
I'm telling the truth. Now, if you ever go to their house, I recently had some lamb chops. I couldn't believe. I'm not going to name names, but they were that big around. And I went boom, boom. I put them both on the same fork and ate them, thinking that was the appetizer. Rich people don't know how to eat.
It's one of the great pleasures of life,
oh,
is to eat.
God,
I
yes.
like food.
And
I like food
and food in Mexico.
Yes,
is
it's very good. Yes, it's
course.
Very good.
Italy's not bad either.
No.
While everybody's looking at relics and touring the churches, I eat.
Yes.
You name for me the city, I'll name for you the restaurant. Rome. I can name the church and the restaurant. Tre Scalini. Oh.
Yes.
You know Tre Scalini?
Yes, Piazza Navona, no?
Oh,
yes.
With
yes.
the Bernini statues
yes, yes,
out
yes,
front.
Yes.
Just eat. Mort, did we eat? Mama Cesarini's. Eat. God. I'm getting hungry as I'm sitting here. As a matter of fact, I'm liable to eat your award if I'm not careful there.
Oh, no, no, no. You have no permission. No.
I want to show you now a scene with Dolores Del Rio from Children of Sanchez. Describes Mexican wife's role and the love that slipped away. Do you know the scene I'm talking about?
No, I don't. I don't know exactly which one.
Well,
I'd like to see
we'll
it.
All be
I haven't
surprised
seen any
together.
Of it, you know, so it's all a surprise for me.
Scene from this rare motion picture, Children of Sanchez, with Dolores Del Rio. Watch.
He's brought another woman into the house. She's about almost 30 years younger. I turned on the light, and there they were. He looked so frightened. I even felt sorry for him.
You are so alike, you and your father. You love each other, and you hate each other.
I want to be on my own. I have to be.
My child, many years will go by before a woman can really be free. If God wants to help a woman, he makes her fall in love.
Love. Men want only one thing from a woman.
Pray to God that you fall in love. It's the most a woman can expect from life.
What about you, Grandmother? Were you ever in love?
Yes. God was good to me.
But why didn't you go with him?
I am a woman, a Mexican wife, a Mexican mother. I had no right to go.
Only a man has any rights.
Let me tell you something I believe. A good woman, a mother, in our life has to be a very special person. She has to accept all the macho ways of our men and still keep her dignity. Still be the heart of the family, the chain which pulls a family together. Your mother was that kind of a woman. And so are you, Consuelo.
Dolores Del Rio, Children of Sanchez. We'll come back. My next guest is the producer-director of The Children of Sanchez. His films, such as Jonathan Livingston Seagull, The Caretakers, All the Young Men, have won him 5 Hollywood Foreign Press Golden Globe Awards and 13 Oscar nominations. Would you please welcome Hall Bartlett.
Hall.
Chose to sit on the side of the beautiful woman over there.
That's the way I was coached, Merv, by your team.
Why did you persist in making this picture? I don't think the whole story has really been explained yet. What drove you to make this picture? You worked, it's 6 years you worked on it.
6 years since I bought the rights, Merv, mm-hmm. Yes. And it's been 4 years since Tony and I shook hands on an agreement for him to make the picture because it was our mutual dream. Why I feel this picture was very important and had to be made was that I think it deals with a problem that not only is in Mexico, but all over the world. The story really that Oscar Lewis wrote is a very human and emotional, dramatic story of people relating to each other, the terrible problem today of communications, of people who don't want to be involved, which certainly is in our society, as well as there and every place I've gone. It's a day, generally speaking, when people are negative about caring about each other and committing to each other. And this is a story of a family of people, of young adults, 4 young adults, with their father, Tony plays, and their grandmother, Dolores plays, who struggle with all the human problems, the hatreds, the loves, the dreams, and the hopes, but struggle to stay together and to build a place and not only survive, but show that what I firmly believe, that we are all more than animals and that we can achieve no matter where we begin, as Tony's story, own story, so dramatically tells, as you brought out in the show, wherever we begin, there's no limit to where we can go. And this, to me, was a very modern story that cut across people of all races and all families, and I was determined to try to make it.
Former Mexican governments would have kept this from being made.
They did.
Oh, they did?
Yes. This, 15 years ago, Carlo Ponti and Joe Levine, with some other people, bought the rights from the galleys. And the Mexican government did not allow them to come into the country to make the picture, and it wasn't until the recent Echeverria regime that they changed their minds after I persuaded them. I spent 6 months in Mexico persuading them to allow us to come there. And then they did, and they gave us the right to film in 72 actual locations, many of them actual locations where the Sanchez family live and work. We met, Tony and I went to Mexico City with Cesare Zavattini, the great Italian writer who wrote the screenplay. We spent several weeks with the Sanchez family, whose real name is Hernandez. And we actually tried to soak into the script the reality, and everything was checked out so that it could be authentic and detailed, because this is the most famous family in modern literature now. This book is known all over the world as a classic everywhere. And the next wonderful chapter for me was that after several months, Dolores agreed to be in the picture, and I think the combination of Tony and Dolores and Lupita, whom you will meet very soon. Really, it's a wonderful moment for me to be here because these three people I love very much.
Could I interrupt a minute to say that about 16 years ago, Sabatini and De Sica came to Mexico, and it was also their dream, you know, to do a film on children of Sanchez. They talked to me about it, and they offered me the part of the mother. And I was very anxious to do it, but of course, Sofia Loren was going to be my daughter at that time, and right. It was going to be directed by De Sica. The government said, no, we couldn't do it. Right. So 16 years later, Hall comes back with the children of Sanchez, and this time Lupita plays my grandchild, and I play the grandmother. This is 16 years later. And I am delighted, you know, that he wanted so much to do the book, that he was so very much in love with the book. I think we all worked with a great deal of love. Isn't that right?
You all did. Paul?
I love, too, what Hall does with the music in his films. Now, Jonathan Livingston Seagull, you went right out and signed Neil Diamond, right, and gave us an incredible recorded score. I mean, that went down in musical history.
It's his only film score, and I think he did a great job.
Yeah. How did you talk him in? Yeah.
Well, Neil was very reluctant because, as you well know, he's so successful with his records and his personal appearances, and it was a new medium, and he was very concerned. He turned me down first. It was my dream to have him do it, and I sent the screenplay to him. He was appearing in New York on Broadway in a one-man show, and he said, I love the book, Hall, but I really don't think I can do that. I've got too much to risk. And then this was before the film was shot. When we finished, we came back from Country You Love, the Big Sur and Carmel country, which was our headquarters for the shooting of the film. I came back and I had a call from Neil, and he said that he had changed his mind and he'd like to do it. And we worked together for 6 months. I ran all the film for him in pieces. I made rough cuts of each piece, and he created, I think, a score. It's still selling very well today. It's a lasting score.
So when you did Children of Sanchez, you went out and signed another writer.
I got very
lucky.
And
here's the album with Chuck Mangione. Now, a lot of people have tried to get him to do scores for motion pictures. A lot of famous people. I don't know how you did this.
Well, he had turned down, he told me, 32 films and had refused to go into this new medium also. And I wanted Merv for this picture. I didn't want what I call a Mexico folklorico score that everyone has done from Viva Zapata on. I wanted today's beat because the picture is very today. I wanted what I call a modern rock rhythm, but with some true Latin ethnic strains in it. And this was a unique combination. I couldn't find it anywhere, and I thought Chuck could do it. And I didn't know him, but I called him in Rochester, where his headquarters are, as you know, and I said, Chuck, would you come out at my expense on a plane and see the rough cut of a motion picture that's the result of the love of a great many people, and I think it will move you and touch you and provoke you to do the best work of your career. And I talked him and his manager, Tom Iannacone, into flying out. They saw a rough cut of the film. It was about 2.5 hours long then, and he fell in love with it. He kept jumping up and down. He's a terrific guy, very enthusiastic, very emotional man, and he kept jumping up and down and saying, that's my family, that's my mother, that's my father. He said about you, dear, as a matter of fact,
that's
he told you
me.
When you saw him, that's my grandmother.
Ah,
and so when he got through, he said, well, this is about my family, I've got to do this.
So he scored his own life.
So he scored his own life.
That's great. Let me take a break and we'll come back. And Lupita Ferrer will join us. My next guest is Venezuela's leading actress and is a popular film star throughout Latin America. She's now making her international film debut in The Children of Sanchez. Would you please welcome the beautiful Lupita Ferrer. Lupita. But you're not available. You sleep with the producer, I hear.
Well, I'm not going
to
tell you.
She's married to him. Don't get excited, folks. This is Mrs. Hall Bartlett. They were so shocked by my statement, they couldn't believe it. You lucky devil, you.
That's right, Merv.
No, I think I'm the one that is very lucky.
Well, isn't that nice?
I'm very, very happy with Hall. I think he's a wonderful man.
He's a persistent devil, isn't he?
Oh, yes. He is very persistent.
When he decides to make a motion picture, nothing stops him, right?
That's right, Merv. Nothing stops him.
Lupita, there are a lot of stars in South America who are great stars, but we wouldn't know them necessarily, would we? I mean, the Latin communities here would know them because they would play the theaters.
Yes, you're right. There are a lot of stars, naturally, in Latin America, but unfortunately, they are a little bit limited to our Latin American countries. That's why I decided to make the move when Hall Bartlett, before he was married to me, incidentally, offered me the part of Consuelo in The Children of Sanchez, because I always had the dream and the hope to do something in world motion pictures.
But why have you no accent at all?
Well, because I went to an American school in Maracaibo.
Ah.
Venezuela. You probably don't know where Maracaibo is, but Maracaibo is the second largest city in Venezuela. And it's the oil center of our country, Murph.
But you have no accent at all.
I went to an American school. There are a lot of Americans, you know, there.
And did you have one teacher?
No.
Whose way of speaking you imitated?
No, I didn't.
See, that is so strange to me, how you could grow up in a foreign country and then come here and have no accent at all unless you...
That really threw me when I first met her.
No, Merv, the school, as I said, was an American school in Maracaibo, and most of the children that went to that school were, you know, children of the people that were working in the oil fields. And remember that I went to the school since I was 9 years old. And when you're that young, you just don't learn, you know, as without an accent.
How will American women take to this motion picture with a philosophy we have heard so far in the clips that doesn't necessarily reflect modern-day American women's thinking?
Well, I'll tell you, Merv, I feel that it does. I think that, particularly, I feel the character that I play in the film, Consuelo, I think reflects today's modern woman. Because Consuelo is a girl that wants to improve herself. I fight a lot with my father, with my dear, dear Tony, to let me have an education. And I want to be somebody, you know, in my life, and I want to be independent, and I want men to respect me as an equal. And I think that this is really a woman's struggle of today.
All right, let's see a scene with Lupita Ferrer in Anthony Quinn, Children of Sanchez, where you accuse Anthony Quinn of being physically in love with his daughter.
That's right.
Well, we're not going to want to miss this one, I'll tell you. Children of Sanchez, Lupita Ferrer.
So I don't love you.
Phoebe, you don't even realize it.
What don't I realize?
That you're always humiliating us. You've done for Tonya in a few days what you haven't done for us in a lifetime.
Have always fed you? Have you ever gone hungry?
No. You've always given us bread, a roof. But do you know why I ever left this house? Because you forced me to. And do you know what I always wanted to be, Father? A nun. I always wanted to enter a convent. But I couldn't, because you never gave me your name. But Tonya, you'd give her your name right away. I'm sure of that.
Yes, I'll give her my name. Maybe I'll give her fur coats and jewels. Maybe I'll give her a limousine.
Father, do you know what they're saying? The whole visita.
What are they saying?
That you're in love with your own daughter. That you want to go to bed with her.
God, that's filthy. You dare.
Don't touch me! You can have your Tonya and all the other women you want. But I'm leaving. And as far as I'm concerned, you're dead. Dead! Dead!
It's quite a scene. From the children of Sanchez, we'll return.
Hello, I'm Jean Marsh, co-creator and one of the stars of Upstairs, Downstairs. The entire Bellamy family, and of course all our servants what work for them downstairs and really do the work, are absolutely thrilled that you're all watching us on Channel 11. So don't forget, we're on every Saturday night.
Well, we've seen great moments on film from this unusual motion picture, Children of Sanchez, and we've listened to conversations with great stars, and I thank you all and wish you much luck and much success.
Thank
with Children
you,
of Sanchez.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, ladies and gentlemen. See you tomorrow. Emotional consideration furnished by Delta Airlines and True Value Hardware Stores. Delta Airlines now flies to London, England, and over 90 other cities in the U.S. and abroad. Delta is ready when you are. At True Value Hardware Stores, quality, selection, and service are why they're number one. Because True Value is more than just a name, it's their way of doing business.